Hello, welcome to a new episode. Today's topic is Linear Regression Part 3, Diagnostics. Today we'll continue with a study about the car's MPG difference between the automatic and the manual transmission. We'll justify the model selection with the diagnostics. We'll apply the analysis of variance as well as the so-called information criteria. Please watch the previous two episodes if you haven't done so already. They will be extremely helpful in understanding the content of today's video. A quick recap. To study the MPG difference between the automatic and the manual transmission, we first calculated the group averages. This would be enough if every other feature were the same except for the transmission type. But definitely, this is not our case. Then, we apply the linear regression models of increasing complexity. However, we are left with a question whether making the model more complex would always give a better solution. So, today we'll try to address this question. Okay, what is the analysis of variance, often called by its acronym ANOVA? The purpose of ANOVA is to parse the different sources of the error. With ANOVA, usually the following quantities are involved. Let's look closely into these three quantities: the sum of squares of regression, SSR, the sum of squares of errors, SSE, and the total sum of squares, SST. The formulas for the SSR, SSE, and SST are given here. The measured values of the dependent variable y are represented by y sub I. The predicted values of y are denoted with this accent that looks like a hat, and the average value of y is denoted by the accent that looks like a flat line. SSR, SSE, and SST are related with each other. The relationship is given by this equation. Now, let's jump into the F statistic and the corresponding p-value. The question we are asking is the given regression model any good at all? Let us rephrase the previous question and ask, is at least any one of the independent variables meaningful in explaining the value of y, the dependent variable? In order to give an answer, we need to do a hypothesis testing called the F test. In the F test, the null hypothesis, or H0, states that all the coefficients are zero, which means that the model is no good at all. The alternative hypothesis, or H1, states that at least one of the coefficients is non-zero, which means that the model captures real pattern. In order to decide whether we take H0 or H1, we calculate the F statistic and the p-value. The formula for the F statistic is like this. Usually, when the corresponding p-value is smaller than 5% or 0.05, the H0 is rejected in favor of the H1 and the model would be of some use. Otherwise, H0 is adopted and the model would be useless. Now, we also have other diagnostic measures as listed here. Let's review some of them in detail. One of the most important measures is the R-square. R-square is the proportion of the variance in the dependent variable that is predictable from the independent variables. And you like to have R-square as close to 1 as possible. Its formula is like this. SSE gets smaller when the predicted y gets closer to the real value, while SST remains the same because we are subtracting the constant average from the real values. As the ratio SSE over SST gets smaller, the R square gets close to 1. Then, I like to focus on these three measures. The information criteria AIC and BIC are closely related to each other. In both AIC and BIC, the first term depends on the logarithmic likelihood. In the second term, p is the number of coefficients or parameters, and n is the number of the observations. What is the use of the AIC or the BIC? It is a very useful measure in optimizing the linear model. We like to minimize the information criteria. To understand why, first, we can notice that the information criteria has two competing terms. The first term, which is minus the logarithmic likelihood, usually decreases as the model becomes more and more complex. However, the complexity comes with a cost. P is the number of parameters. As P increases, the second term also increases. The information criteria is sum of these two competing trends. And there is a kind of a sweet spot where the total sum has a minimum. We would like to increase the model complexity just enough, but not too much. So, we can summarize our strategy. We improve the model by applying the following criteria. The p-value of the f-test should remain small, smaller than 0.05. R-square should get closer to 1. And we should make sure that SSE and AIC keep decreasing. If the model is changed in the wrong direction, the AIC may start to increase instead of decreasing. Then, it's time to stop changing the model. Examples. A quick recap about the dataset. The dataset comes from the 1974 Motor Trend US magazine. This dataset shows the MPG or miles per gallon and 10 other features of the car design. MPG would be the dependent variable and others would be the possible independent variables. In total, we have 32 car models. Now, we'll go through the same linear models we had applied in the previous episode and do the diagnostics. The first model has a single independent variable, which is AM. AM is a so-called dummy variable, which can be either 0 or 1 depending on the transmission type of the car. We have the dataset as we can see here. The columns are named after the variables. These columns correspond to the MPG and 10 other features. Now we switch to this new sheet, which contains only those columns that we're going to use. We go to the PrimaXL tab, select Linear, and then Fit. We fill out the blanks with the cell ranges for X and Y. Also, we specify the output location. Now, your attention please. Do you remember that we had unchecked these boxes in the previous episode? This time, we'll leave them as checked. Finally, we press the Run button to execute. As usual, we have the coefficients of the model. However, we have some more results corresponding to the diagnostics. For example, we have the R-square, SSR, SSE, SST, F-statistic, and its p-value, AIC, and BIC. In this summary table, we have the key results. F-test, which is okay, R-square, SSE, and AIC. Now, we move on. The second model is more complex. it has three independent variables, AM, HP, and WT. Again, AM is a variable that can be either 0 or 1 depending on the transmission type. HP is the horsepower and WT is the weight. Instead of going back to the spreadsheet and repeat all over, here we just show the diagnostic result. We go to our summary table. We can notice that our square got much closer to 1 in comparison with the model number 1. SSC and AIC both have decreased. So, we are more confident that the model number 2 is an improvement over the first model. Now, the next linear model. Here, X1, X2, and X3 are the same as before. However, we have the so-called interaction term, which is X1 times X3, or AM times WT. The diagnostic results are as shown here. Back to our summary table, we can see that our square has increased while the SSC and the AIC have decreased. Again, the model number 3 is an improvement over the previous model. In the previous episode, we stopped at the model number 3. However, we are left with a lingering question. How about we include more terms? For example, how about we include all of the 10 features as the independent variables? The diagnostic result is as shown here. And in the summary table, we can see all the bad signs. R square is not any closer to 1, and the AIC has increased instead of decreasing. So, this model is not better than the previous one. Does this prove that the model number 3 is the absolute best we can think of? No. Some of you may want to explore more complex models. You are free to do so. However, we are now more confident than before that the model number 3 was a reasonable choice without spending too much time and effort. Summary. Today we showed how to diagnose a linear model. We used the ANOVA method and the information criteria. We discussed about how to monitor the improvement of the model. Please visit our Facebook page for more information and videos. Also, make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can find the PrimaXL installer at our GitHub repository. Thank you so much. Until next time, bye.